عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله كما ينبغي لجلال وجهه وعظيم سلطانه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله مالك الملك يؤتي الملك من يشاء وينزع الملك ممن يشاء ويعز من يشاء ويذل من يشاء بيده الخير، إنه على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمداً حبيب الله ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أرسل على فترة من الرسل وقلة من العلم وضلالة في الناس، لو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا ما ألفت بين قلوبهم ولكن الله ألف بينهم. من يطع الله والرسول فلا مضل له، ومن يعص الله والرسول فلا هادي له. أما بعد، brothers and sisters, Jalla Jalaluh says, instructing, teaching, and guiding us. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا، واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها، كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون. ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون. ولا تكونوا كالذين اختلفوا وتفرقوا من بعد ما جاءهم البينات. This ayah is not a new ayah that you are hearing. At least you have probably heard it 3 times this occasion during the past 3 years. Allah is speaking to you and to us individually and collectively. Extended connection, and by doing so we are obeying him. By coming closer to each other, by eliminating perceived differences, by blotting out notions of prejudice. In doing so, we are obeying Allah the same way we obey Him with our prayers and our rituals. But a word of truth and fact is in order as we try to be as frank as sincere as possible with ourselves, and try not to think that everything is rosy when sometimes the case is not so. Every year, on the occasion of the birth of Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we try to revive this occasion in a week of unity that has been designated by the leadership of the Islamic Revolution. And then the week passes by, and we enter a full year of experiences and encounters with each other in a limited circle and in a more expanded circle, meaning we here and the others beyond us who are also committed to the Islamic Revolution, and a circle beyond that that does not or cannot, for some reasons or others, commit themselves to the Islamic Revolution. And in the encounters that we have within these fluctuating circles, we do have elements of the past that try to violate the order of Allah to maintain a firm hold on the issue of unity and unification and solidarity among us, as relative as that may be possible sometimes. Let us try to remember, not for the sake of rehabilitating a failing memory, but for the sake of trying to avoid the notions and the ideas that work to separate us during the coming year. How many of us, and let us be in this hour of worship and in the presence of Allah, let us be frank to ourselves. How many of us have had their days or their hours of weaknesses in which they entertained a notion of sectarian or denominational or national or racial feelings or ideas that tend to draw you or draw us apart? This is a fact of life that the shaitan ways to encroach upon the unpolluted brotherhood that Muslims share with each other by these different notions. And then, when a Muslim begins to dismiss in an hour or in a day a feeling of solidarity and camaraderie with his brother or sister Muslim, then that is the stepping stone to a larger and a more concentrated meaning of that notion. And for years, the enemies, and we have many of them, have tried to inflate these notions and these ideas among the Muslims to divide them. And throughout the centuries, the Muslims have been on a course of continuous fragmentation and division because of these notions and the sub-notions that come out of them. And for this time period, the submission to Allah has been made ever more strenuous because of these notions of divide, of separatism, that made it possible for other gods to introduce themselves into the lives of the Muslims and then to split their loyalties and their allegiance. Brothers and sisters, if the superpowers, as they classify themselves, with the purported differences among them, an atheist block of power, as it were, compared to, in whatever sense of the word, a block that claims to believe in God, these forces have come and assembled and spoke about common objectives and common grounds with all the antagonism and with all the propaganda and with all the fanfare. Contradictory rhetoric and principles between the two. All of that did not ban them from sitting together and understanding themselves and their objectives. If this can be the case, then it behooves the Muslims, with the many common principles and points that they have among themselves, and it is more likely in the nature of things that these Muslims come and understand each other within whichever circle they may be in. There is nothing to inhibit the motivation and then the materialization of the meeting of minds between the Muslims. Before the Islamic Revolution, there were delegations and scholars from different Islamic organizations that were dispatched attached to establish bridges of dialogue and exchanges of opinions between the Muslims or whom they represent of the Muslims and al-Yahud and al-Nasara. We have heard, and although the Islamic Revolution made this news item, of insignificance today, because if it is brought to the attention of the public, some serious questioning would settle in to the conscience of the Muslim collective mind. Hence, the frantic efforts of so-called Islamic associations, assemblies, governments, and whatnot, their frantic efforts to begin a dialogue with the Vatican or with other religious institutions belonging to the Judeo-Christian heritage or context. And we remember, less than 10 years ago, the exchange of visits that took place between a delegation of Muslims leaving the Arabian Peninsula, dispatched by the rulers in Saudi Arabia to the Vatican, and then the publication of the minutes of that meeting to try to infer to the public, audience, Muslim or otherwise, that there are many grounds of commonality between Muslims and quote-unquote Ahl al-Kitab. And then, within these exchanges and frantic efforts, the Islamic Revolution anchors itself of the Muslims. And these types of exchanges are omitted from public mention, or at the very most occupy an area in the periphery and in the margins of newsmakers. Why? Because there is an internal process that seeks to divide the Muslims. And this internal process that wants to divide the Muslims originates from the same source that wanted to unite the Muslims with al-Yahud and al-Nasara. Today, Muslim Ummah, among the Muslim peoples, there's an area of weakness concerning the issue of Islamic unity. As we here in the United States are familiar with the intense of prejudice that exist in the South more intensely than they exist in other parts of this land. Feelings of prejudice, and there's a weak area in the Muslim body that has a concentration of those feelings, but not along racial lines. Allah subhanahu has saved the Muslims from being racially conscious. But this time along denominational and then sectarian proportions, that renders this area a source upon which the enemies of the Muslims can tap to isolation, alienation, and then division and separation among the Muslims. This line of weakness in the Muslim body exists in the Arabian Peninsula and in the Gulf area and in parts of Iraq. This has to be identified, and it has to be known to the Muslims, as we know that there is an intensification of racial consciousness in the southern parts of this land more than there is anywhere else. And then the more the Muslims distance themselves and walk away from that area, the less the feelings of antagonism, hostility, and division, the less they exist. Whether you go towards the east or you go towards the west, this area of weakness has to be diagnosed and identified as the first step for the cure of the notions of division among the Muslims. And these notions and ideas have no place and no justification in a Muslim mind or in a Muslim soul. They don't exist. They didn't exist in the days of the Prophet, and they shouldn't exist today. But nevertheless, human nature being what it is, we do have these people who, if they are presented with the ayah, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, they automatically dismiss the other side of the Muslims by saying, we do not relate to them, or we do not belong to them. As we can see, this issue has even been extended from that area thousands and thousands of miles away, and in an artificial sense, implanted among different Muslim congregations, even in this land, after the Muslims had the chance and the opportunity to breathe an air of freedom. These people, with their concocted ideas and emotions, come and try to infest their disease into the bodies of other clearly thinking and feeling Muslims. How many of us have tried to question the part that traditionalism plays in as far as obscuring the objective of unifying the Muslims? We have been praying here in front of the nationalized house of Allah for about 2.5 years. The issue of praying with your hands extended to your side or your hands put upon your belly is a minor issue that does not figure in to the basics of Iman. But with the message of unity, we don't expect those people across the street, the majority of whom are employed by the sources that want to divide the Muslims. We don't expect a gesture of unification and unity to come from them. We are the ones who are responsible for pioneering an effort to extend our hand of unity and brotherhood to the deceived among those who are across the street. And because traditionalism plays a role to divide the Muslims, Muslims, we find among us, in order to hamper a communication process between us and them, those who come from a traditional background in which they extend their hands to their side are trying to serve the traditional argument across the street that wants to deceive the simpleton Muslims that come across there and then present the issue that is political in nature here as a sectarian issue. Shiites across the street and Sunnis inside the masjid. And what helps their argument is the traditionalism that we find here with the political message that we want to communicate to the deceived Muslims across the street. The simple process of extending your hand to your side, which is a very marginal issue. Of course, Allah can see and hear you, whether you have your hand on your breast or whether you have it on your side, whether you prayed like the Prophet when he was praying in one form or the other. You extend a message of brotherhood to the Muslims across the street, and then you bypass the traditional argument that they are building on the other side, and then you avoid one extreme feeding on the other extreme, and in the process deceiving the Muslims. But even after 2.5 years, we still haven't understood that the political message we want to communicate to the other side is larger and more important than a traditional message that we are communicating by what we do, which is more effectual and efficacious than by that we are saying. Because acts and deeds speak louder than words and than verbiage. Brothers and sisters in Islam, if we want to recognize a process of unity, of bringing the Muslims towards each other, of building a solid base that respects the interpretation or the ijtihad of other Muslims, we have to take the first step. We have to set the act into motion. We cannot expect it to come from those who are not independent, from those who owe their allegiance and who owe their lives to a salary that they receive at the end of the month. We cannot expect from a person who officiates the Jumu'ah prayer across the street, who is nothing but a civil servant in the government of Saudi Arabia, to have or to take upon himself an effort of bypassing the traditional and the political obstacles that exist between us and between the larger Muslims or the Muslims at large. It is our responsibility. It falls squarely upon our shoulders. And by understanding some of the potential that we have, that we even haven't utilized up until now, we can be more effective than we have been in the past. There is no doubt also that there is a communication breakdown between the proponents of Islamic revolution and the larger Muslim audience in the world. A breakdown that is not necessary. And when a person begins to look and to think and to analyze eyes and put his hand on the source of that communication breakup, he finds in the final analysis that there are threads leading to traditionalism. He finds that there is no confidence in the Muslims on the other side. And in the process, the Islamic revolution continues upon the shoulders of the combatants of Islam. And we are busy in issues of traditionalism, in issues of history, withdrawn into the past. Some of us go to certain du'as, supplications on different nights. And then when Allah says, come to Friday prayers, some may not appear at Friday prayers, as if the dua in one of these nights is... Some may not appear at Friday prayers, as if the dua in one of these nights is more important than the institution of Friday prayers. And not even that, the same dua takes place at a couple of places in the same area. And we want unity. And we speak for the unification of the Muslims. What we do is heard by the near and the distant Muslim more than what we say. We can praise Islamic unity for generations to come, but Muslims and people are not listening to words. They are following actions. They are looking at what you do. Are you sincere to your words? You want to unite the Muslim when you and yourself are divided. Or you are a united, solid front and you want to progress into the middle of the other Muslims to create out of them a united and solid front. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ صَفًّا كَأَنَّهُمْ بُنْيَانٌ مَرْصُوصٌ. Allah likes those who fight in His cause as if they were one solid rank. And you don't fight as one solid rank when you are living in the past. You are living in the present. You are witnessing and you are defying the forces that are aligned against you. And with traditionalism embedded into us, and with politics a secondary issue, we cannot hope for a more elaborate process to try to unify the Muslims. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu and the Prophet have made the issue of unity a binding issue upon us. And everyone who violates the notion of unity with his brother Muslim is violating the order of Allah, as much as he may appear to be pious and religious and spiritual in a traditional sense. ادعوا الله سبحانه وأنتم موقنون بالإجابة واستغفروه يغفر لكم إنه كان غفارا يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا ويمددكم بأموال وبنين ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم أنهارا. الحمد لله الذي هدى وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه أولي النهى والتقى. Brothers and sisters in Islam, a person, a Muslim, who is living the contemporary developments that are taking place concerning the Muslims and concerning his own or her own destiny, cannot but think of the impact that unity has upon the Muslims and upon the rest of the world from a power perspective. When Allah says, وَأَعِدُّ لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ, and prepare as much power as you can against your enemies. Obviously, we cannot muster any power or any force or strength against our enemies if we are divided. We have to be united. And this unity has to serve as the basis for the power and the force that we encounter our enemies with. So even from a power interpretation of the issues around us that beg us in their own logic and in their own nature, the issues around us in the absence of Allah's guidance and for the sake of our own survivability, the issues around us beg us to be powerful and to be strong and to be confident. And hence, the issues around us, the nature of things around us, is begging us to be united. What type of excuse can we hold in our hand and approach Allah on the day of accountability as an alibi for us not being united? How can some of us justify and try to compete with an established Islamic order and leadership and then try to act as a competitor or a parallel to that established order, authority, and leadership? If we do not want to wake up and live the issues as we are presented with them, Allah's Sunnah will overcome our ignorance, because it is not waiting there for us to wake up and then work its way in life. It is working its way in life whether we wake up or whether we are still dumbfounded and sleeping. If we do not unite, then there is no force that is going to intervene with the counter-Islamic forces for mercy on our behalf. We would have incurred the consequences of humiliation and defeat because we were divided by the intention and the purpose and determination of our own selves. No one is forcing you as an individual or as a representative of individuals to be divided and away from the other Muslims. You make that decision by your own self. No one is forcing you not to communicate with the other Muslims, whether they are related to you in one way or the other, or not related to you in one way or the other, physical or material, because the bondage of Islam bypasses everything physical and everything material. In the time of the Prophet, may Allah's peace
peace and blessings be upon him. There were those different categories of people. There were the munafiqoon, who had overtly, publicly declared their Islam. The process of communication between the Muslims and this segment of society that was very critical, even in the very existence of an Islamic society, the process of communication was not cut off. The Quran, Allah subhanahu, from above seven heavens, addressed this issue. There were tulaqa, the prisoners of war, who were set free after the incorporation of Mecca into the authority of Islam. There were those who are described as من قاتل قبل الفتح من أنفق قبل الفتح من جاهد قبل الفتح وقاتل. There are those who are described as من جاهد بعد الفتح وقاتل. There are أصحاب بيعة الرضوان. There are the Muhajirun. There are the Ansar. This did not break down the process of communication between all of them, who were under the umbrella of Islam, sincerely or supposedly. There was communication from the sources and the levels of Islam, the circle, the immediate circle of the Prophet, to all of these and even beyond. How can we justify an encroaching isolationism among ourselves, and we do not even measure up to some of these people around the Prophet alayhi wa alihi salatu wa salam? This is the issue, brothers and sisters, of unity. And then our behavior, our decisions seem to indicate that we know more about unity than the office from which the week of unity was designated, as a week to be remembered and celebrated and an incentive and a spur for further Islamic coordination and solidarity. Do we know more than the scholars, Jami'i Shara'at wal Mu'ahilat, who have declared this week a week of unity, to try to break down this unity by some of us avoiding Jumu'ah prayers, or some of us holding the same meeting or the same function at two different places, or some of us entertaining the notion that you are prejudiced? What types of justifications can we present to Allah on this week? In this day, we should present ourselves with the obstacles to the unity that we foresee, and not play as if these obstacles do not exist. Let us be realistic in life, and then confront these obstacles as we identify them. But to go on acting in this vein and in this direction only serves, in the final analysis, the scheme of the enemies that want to divide. That is the only way they defeated the Muslims. They divided them. They divided them along national lines, along sectarian lines, if possible, and alhamdulillah, that was not possible, along racial lines. They try everything possible to divide the Muslims. And then we unwillingly participate in this process. We only ask Allah subhanahu for forgiveness in this unwitting participation. And we ask Allah subhanahu to provide us with the insight to pinpoint and to diagnose these problems so that we may remedy them. Allahumma ihdina fi man hadayt wa عافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيمن توليت، وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت، وقنا شر ما قضيت، فإنك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك، وإنه لا يذل من واليت، ولا يعز من عاديت، تباركت ربنا وتعاليت، فلك الحمد على ما قضيت، نستغفرك ونتوب إليك، وصلى الله على محمد وآل محمد. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق، وأنت خير الفاتحين. ربنا لا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا، ربنا لا تجعلنا فتنة للذين كفروا، ربنا إنك سميع الدعاء. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من أن نشرك بك شيئا نعلمه، ونستغفرك لما لا نعلمه. ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا، وثبت أقدامنا، وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها، وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل، إن الله نعما يعظكم به، إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. إن الله ينهى، إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم